Thank you very much, Maja. Good morning, everybody. To be able to address you this morning, which is afternoon in Nairobi. I am thankful to the British Library, to King's College, and to Oxford University for the invitation, and I regret for not having been able to be with you physically, and this is partly my fault. I have been traveling so long that I could not dedicate enough time for visa application at the UK embassy. Usually I get it in 48 hours, but I was in Paris, actually. I am also chairing the UNESCO International Fund for the Promotion of Culture, that some of you may know. And we had a meeting there, so I overstayed a little bit. So now I am addressing you actually now from the regional office, UNESCO regional office in Nairobi. My good friend Mohammed Jalid, the director, has offered me his office to do this. I am thankful to him. He would have loved to be with us together with his colleagues in charge of education and IT, but they are all in a mission in the region. They are covering 13 regions, 13 countries in East Africa and the Great Lakes region. I was based here in Nairobi when I was, as Maja just said, when I was leading the UNESCO Regional Program for Emergency Education and Communication and Culture of Peace. I hasten to say that I am not a librarian by training. I am a student of culture. And I always promoted and wanted to promote the idea of cultural diplomacy. And I have practiced it actually in the various posts where I have been. And the fact that I have been selected to lead the National Library of Sudan maybe is related to that question of cultural diplomacy. We are talking about the changes that have been occurring around us thanks to the digital divide. One of the changes that I have noted also is that more and more the world is becoming aware of the interlinkages between culture, conflict, and peace, or lack of it. And this has been a major theme of my career, my 40 years career. Usama Reis, who is a friend of mine and a colleague of mine, I'm happy that he's representing Sudan, who is there and who's leading the City for African Knowledge in Sudan, would tell you that we have been working together on many issues related to culture and conflict and culture and development in Sudan. This morning, I would like to talk to you about what I call Digital Sudan, Digitizing Cultural Heritage for the Democratization of Knowledge. And I see that you have been talking about the production of knowledge. I can say, I think without fearing any opposition, that production of knowledge in the has not been up to our expectations or to our aspirations. But more and more now we see efforts around the South, the various countries of the South, that they are doing a lot of effort and putting more resources into the issue of knowledge and the issue of creation of knowledge. But of course, a lot needs to be done. I would say that the evolving conditions worldwide in the global and in the global South provide opportunities. You have been talking about these opportunities. You have been talking about those challenges. So I'm not going to elaborate a lot on that. I am sure among you there are many experts who can address this issue of challenges and opportunities. But there are some challenges that are, I wouldn't say close to my heart, which I find very worrisome. They may be linked to the digital advance, but also they are having a life of their own. I am here talking about the issue of radicalization. I have been working on culture of peace since the inception of the UNESCO program in the early 90s. And I have been working on conflict resolution in this region for 15 years. And I have been always advocating the necessity of establishing strong linkages between the issue of knowledge, the issue of heritage, and the issue of social change and social transformation. Unfortunately, we have not given enough attention to this, but I am glad to note that now libraries and archives are giving more attention now to the issue of archiving knowledge, cultural heritage. The issue of cultural heritage in many countries of the South, including my own country, have been part of the problem in many cases, rather than being part of the solution. In many of the countries of the South, the past is taken very seriously. It's taken so seriously, and sometimes it constitutes a kind of blockage to our vision to the future. And we remain bogged down in our memorialization, I would say negative memorialization of the past. And this is one of the main constraints that we have been encountering. And second, the other issue that I would also say is that the issue of creation of knowledge and information and communication and the landscape thereof suffers in many countries of what I call a structural inconsistencies or political, social, or cultural constraints. In many cases, digital advances have exposed that the fact of reaping the benefits of such advances is not only and purely a technological process, but it requires nothing less than a cultural revolution that encompasses mindsets, political and social structures, as well as channels of communication and processing of knowledge across the board. But this also, as you all know, poses the issue of content, decision-making, capacity building. You have been talking about this. And development of required technical and managerial skills, which take us back also to the issue, the political issue, and the issue of choices by the state, and the issue of access and control. When it comes to the issue of selection of content, there is a need to bridge the gap in a participatory way between the technical and academic part of the decision-making process on the one hand, and the political one on the other. And this is not an easy issue to resolve. In culturally diverse societies, my own country is one of them, this can be an extremely divisive issue, which is more often than not swept under the carpet. And if you sweep it under the carpet, the carpet becomes a kind of a line, a cultural and political landmine. In countries such as Sudan, digital advances have brought to the forefront issues such as the approach to modernization, the debate over history and national heritage, freedom of access and state control, coordination and harmonization between the various actors engaged in the educational and knowledge creation and sharing process, as well as those of adequate resources and capacity building. Technology has offered a valuable tool of expression to the dissident voices, but also a space for radical elements through which they are gaining access to a wider public. Slowly but surely, the digital advance is changing the way countries and educational institutions in the South conceive the educational process, as well as the way they plan and select their academic resources, including academic books. And here I would quote my own president, President al-Bashir, who only 5 days ago made a statement when he was addressing the ruling party, the majority party leading organ. He said, we are now going to do the educational process differently. We are going to change these processes in such a way that the laptop and the electronic screen are going to be the main tools in the classroom. And this is a very important statement from Sudan. When I was UNESCO representative in Ethiopia some 9 years ago, and Djibouti and Somalia, I noticed that the Ethiopians had already started in many of their schools using the plasma and using the laptops. In Kenya, here now they are actively distributing laptops, tens of thousands of them in primary schools. And this is an issue which is being debated now. Some of people think that it's a little bit too late, but it is happening. So this is the atmosphere. The whole ecosystem, as Maja said, is changing. The use of plasma laptops in the classroom, classroom, as well as open sources and distance education links, are gradually replacing the traditional methods of learning. Undoubtedly, this phenomenon will expand in the years to come and may cause the complete transformation of the educational systems in the most dramatic way. I am sure our brothers from India addressed that issue yesterday, and it was one of the topics that you have addressed. So, in a nutshell, we are witnessing what I would say a kind of a shift in which academics are being looked at in a different way, and in which issue of culture and issue of heritage is gaining a lot of interest in many countries, and bearing in mind that it's linked to many of the conflicts that we are witnessing now. You spoke about the Middle East yesterday, and this is one region which has been grappling with the issue of culture and cultural heritage for so long. And we see what is happening now in some of the countries of that region, maybe as a result of what I would call the misappropriation and misrepresentation of cultural heritage. To my mind, more needs to be done to democratize the decision-making process and bring it more in line with the requirements of modern times and the needs of the beneficiaries. Now I'm going to turn to one experience that we have been dealing with in Sudan during the last 3 years. And I'm glad that Professor Marilyn Degan is with us this morning. She's one of the organizers of this conference because she contributed very effectively to this experience and visited Sudan at least two or three times to help shape or craft this experience that we call Digital Sudan, digitizing the cultural heritage of Sudan. Aware of the role it can play in enhancing the visibility of arts and humanities and their interrelation with other issues of interest to the people, such as national identity and the role of heritage in shaping the future of the country, the Sudan National Heritage Initiative, the National Library, initiated with other national and international partners a project for the digitization and archiving of national cultural heritage. Foremost among the national partners is the Sudanese Association for Archiving Knowledge, SUDAK, which was the main promoter of this idea at its inception and played a major of archiving the cultural heritage came as an initiative in which we wanted to put together public institutions such as the National Library, National Archives, National Radio, National TV, and the Ministry of Culture, Ministry of Education, and Ministry of Information, and some of the universities, including the Africa Knowledge City, led by my good friend Osama raised with you now, and with non-governmental and I would say private sector institutions. And the objective of that initiative was to constitute a national team, which should bring together all the minds and the institutional and technical capacities engaged in archiving and digitizing knowledge in Sudan, and build a kind of a common, I would say, center or a common hub of knowledge that would enable creation of knowledge, digitization of knowledge, and sharing of knowledge at the national and regional and international levels. This team, which I have the privilege and the honor of leading, has been operational for a number of years now, and it is led by the National Library, and the National Library is quite new in Sudan. The National Archive is quite, I would say, has been there for some time. It was initiated by the British administrators when they were in Sudan over 60 or 70 years ago. And now it is one, I think, or one of the most established national archives in the area, with something like 17 million items of heritage, as old as, some of them as old as the 16th, 17th century. The National Library is quite new. The law of the National Library was voted in 1999, and it started being operational only in 2005, 2006. And I have been at the head of the library for the last 5 years now. The experience of what we call the national team for the digitization and archiving of national heritage, cultural heritage, has been operational, and I think it has been useful in playing and putting together and collectively identify, collect, preserve, and publicize according to the terms and conditions of national individual ownership of intellectual property, items of cultural heritage, and mobilize required technical and financial resources for restoration, digitization, and archiving processes. It plays an advisory role to the Minister of Culture and Minister of Information and relevant government ministers and departments, as well as non-government entities engaged or interested in the areas of competence of this team. It has been trying to raise the awareness of the Sudanese people of their rich cultural and historical heritage, which is often unknown, neglected, undervalued, or underestimated. In recent years, much has been done in the area of information and popularization of cultural heritage, and a growing awareness of the importance and value of cultural heritage. Increasingly, individuals, families, and regional entities at the levels of the states are keen to document and archive their rich historical heritage. This is apparent in the number of books and videos and radio and TV programs that have been edited in the last few years, which are a major contribution to the broader project of archiving knowledge. And I'm happy that this is happening now. If you want to establish a link between this popular effort and the knowledge creation and archiving processes and the academic curriculum creating process, you need to have a kind of a process. You need to establish a team, and you need to establish an institutional capacities that will enable you to do that. So far, this is missing in many countries of the South, including Sudan, and the knowledge creation and sharing process, and this newly found raising of awareness is yet to be reflected in the academic domain. And I think this is one of the things that we have been trying to do. We have been trying also to draw a roadmap and a framework for the digitizing and archiving Sudan cultural heritage. This is considered to be one of the essential tasks entrusted to this team. A national framework for the digitization and archiving of cultural heritage is essential to ensure coherence, harmonization, and integration. It can help save time, resources, and energies. We have structures, we have created structures to do this work, a general assembly composed of the members of this, and a technical team also composed of the of its members, and this team is playing an important role in advising us as how to best proceed with the task of building an institutional and technical framework for the processes. We have called concerning our external partnership, which are very important to us, because a country like Sudan is, which is lacking in many ways, not only, I'm here mentioning only financial resources, but of course technical resources, institutional capacities, and experience. We would like to draw from experiences around the world, and we have so far called upon some of our internal partners. I hasten to say that some of the private sector bodies were interested in this, and I would like to mention Dal Group of Sudan and Hajar Group of Sudan, who are financing some of the projects that we are dealing with, such as archiving. One main project that we have been trying to support is the one engaged in digitizing the TV and radio archives, which is a project that's being implemented by the Birmingham University and supported and funded partially by the DAG group. The digitization of the Sudan, very rich Sudan photo archives, about 7 million photos, which are there in deplorable situations. And we would like to see what we can do about that. We have extended relations and partnership with Durham University that I visited some years ago, and we received visits from the Durham Sudan Collection Group a couple of times, King's College of London, Oxford, the University of Bergen, the World Digital Library, of which we are members, and we are trying now to see how we can benefit from the experience of the World Digital Library. I visited it a couple of times in Washington, and now our technical team is working to see to select the most notable and representative cultural heritage item that we can post on the WDL website. We are working also with the Carter Center, the Emory University, Georgia Tech, WIPO, and we are trying to benefit from the experience of those institutions. Our membership, the membership of this team, very quickly, we have about 22 members. Just to give you an idea about who they are: the National Library of Sudan, the Ministry of Culture, Ministry of the Information, Sudanese Association for Archiving of Knowledge, SUDAC, which is the Secretary General of this team, the National Archives of Sudan, National Cooperation of Antiquities and Museums, Sudan National Intellectual Property Council, Sudan Radio Corporation, Sudan National Television, Sudan Photo Archives, Sudanese Livelihoods Documentation Center, and National Research Center, Sudan National Commission for UNESCO, Ministry of Higher Education and Scientific Research, University of Khartoum, University of Wadi El Nil, Future University, DAG Group, Kinana Group, Sudatel, Africa City of Technology, Hakim, which is represented by Osama Arreis, who is with you now, Studio Rashid, Sudan Film Association. And I have mentioned some of the activities that we have been through so far, but the most important thing for us was building a team that would work together, that is committed to work together, and that would like to support I mentioned two of the projects, the National TV Project and the National Sudan Photo Archives Project, but also support an interesting project, actually, which is that of support to the archives of the Ministry of Justice. The Ministry of Justice, when they heard about this team, they said, why don't you come and work with us? And now our technical team is working with them in order to help them with to develop their capacities to archive the. And of course, with the National Archives of Sudan, we have been working also on the issue of collection of manuscripts. In Sudan, there are many manuscripts that are in the households and in the hands of the people who are reluctant to cede them to anybody. And we, together, we have been working to see how best we can convince the owners of those manuscripts to give them, and how can we provide guarantees that this will remain their property. And there is here, of course, a kind of intellectual property issue to be resolved. Future challenges, I would enumerate some of them. One of them, the first one I would call, how to navigate the thin line between government control and civil society initiative. And this has been the task of this team to try and do such that. To ensure the sustainability and visibility of public-private partnerships. 3, coordinate with powerful and well-resourced public sector bodies, such as the National Documentation Center. And Osama Reis, who is with you, will certainly tell you about his own experience with the National Documentation Center and give you more information about it. Coordinate with other national projects, such as the UNESCO-sponsored cultural mapping project. This project, which is ongoing, and it is working also on issue of documentation of national heritage. Resolve the intellectual property issues. Continue and reinforce partnerships with international partners. Build capacity at the managerial, professional, and technical levels. Garner the necessary political will to provide required resources. Effectively contribute to the debate on cultural heritage and building the knowledge society. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your attendance.
Thank you, Dr. Satti, very much. That's a really powerful presentation, and I was empathizing all the way in terms of various balances and issues and challenges that you mentioned. I'm especially glad you are talking from the National Library perspective, and I think what we heard about these balances around the knowledge creation and the national identity and the state is certainly something that that is kind of the role and a staple of work of every national library. But I think also in terms of what you were telling us about reality and the balances of private and public partnerships, and also your amazing ambition in terms of working with non-textual formats, I must tell you that's something really near to our heart at the British Library, because this is something we are struggling with day in and day out. So with the radio, we actually have remit here at the British Library, and we are working on that. On the TV in the UK, the BBC has been struggling with the archival issues for many years. So it seems to me that the size of ambition that you have described to us is really amazing and probably really nation-changing by the sound of it. So I'm going to open it to the questions from the floor. And it's really important that people get the microphone, otherwise you won't be heard by Dr. Satti. So any questions? There's one over there and one at the front.
Hello, Dr. Satti. My name is Francis Gotto. I work with Durham University. Yeah. I heard what you said about the democratization of the selection process for digitization, and I think that's a very good idea. And would you agree with me that decisions have to be made, but the key thing is to transparently record how that decision was made, and perhaps sometimes to say what wasn't selected and why?
Yeah, no, of course. I mean, the essence of democracy is transparency. And I do agree. Well, let me say hello to you, Mr. Goto. We have not met yet, but I have met with your colleagues who have been very helpful to us in many ways through the years. And I hope to be able to visit Durham soon. No, the issue of democratization, I think this is very important because and it's at the heart of what we would like to do. Not only in political terms, because we always treat the issue of democratization as a political process. For me, this is only the tip of the iceberg. It's only the tip of the iceberg. The essence of the democratization process in countries like ours is what kind of social, what kind of cultural, what kind of intellectual, what kind of personal rights infrastructure that you put in place. And the issue of selection of content, whether the issues of heritage or the issue of the academic in content, and what parts or items of that content can be formatted or introduced into the curriculum, for example, is an issue, an extremely important issue. I agree with you that it has to be recorded, it has to be participatory, as I said, the people in general have to be informed about what's going on and how this selection process is being done and who is doing it and how the items are being selected and why they are being selected and why are we selected such an item or such a, not another item. To give you an example, I am a member of the National Secretariat for the National Dialogue, which is going on in Sudan now, and I participated in a couple of meetings of the Identity Commission, for example, and there was a heated debate on the issue of national heritage within the National Dialogue, and precisely about what aspects of the heritage have been selected throughout the years and not other ones. So I agree with you that the selection process has to be transparent, participatory, and people have to, the beneficiaries, who are the bulk of the people, have to really know why such an item is being selected and not another. And this is a very serious issue.
Thank you, Nureldin. This is Sam Reis. Thank you, Nureldin. Alhamdulillah, good. We miss you here. Actually, thank you. You have sailed with us in different seas and you have given us a comprehensive idea about what is going on. I will not add more on that. But I would like to look at the future, what we need. Like you said, it is a shift. And we need to go through a process of digital transformation for different entities, for the people. We can't do it business as usual. So we need to work on the transformation. We need to engage, as well as democratization, we need the open access initiative to be clear for the people, and the task will not be completed unless we involve as much people as possible, and there are lots who will love to participate on voluntary basis. So how can we use social networks, use different types of available technologies to engage the people, to put their efforts in. So these are the bits and pieces which I would like to add on the future work. And fortunately, we were just having a meeting before your paper, and we'll be going for a second round of Khartoum conference again. We will be with Merlin and with Durham University and with Liverpool and hopefully the British Library and others to arrange a second session over there and maybe a session here also, so that we'll create enthusiasm and team building and all these things, and all are invited for this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Osama. Of course, I fully agree. When Osama is talking, he's expressing the point of view of the team, because he's he's a notable member of SUDAC, of what we call this national team. And I'm happy that Osama is there, and now he's holding meetings with our friends and partners. And I fully concur with the ideas that presented by Osama. We look at the future. We do not want to be bogged down by the past. The past is the past, but the future is more important than the past, of course. The past is important, but the future is even more important. Sudan has gone through very difficult times in the last decades, and now it's coming out of the woods, I would say. There is a new spirit. There is a new spirit in Sudan. There is a national dialogue. There is a will to change. We realize that we are entering the seriously now the 21st century, and all that Osama has mentioned needs to be done. And we call on our partners. We want to be really partners in a global movement for the creation of knowledge, which would be transparent, which would be equitable, which would be just, in which everybody comes with what they can offer, with due respect to all cultures, to all civilizations, to all heritages, and in a spirit of not competition, but in a spirit of complementarity. We cannot do it alone. We are in it together. We are all in the same boat. Look around you, what's happening in this world, these pitiful conditions in which we are. I think we deserve better. And we can do better. I think we can do it together.
Thank you. I think there's a question at the front. Shamil, were you just there? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Satti. It's fascinating stuff, and I look forward to coming to use the libraries and archives in Khartoum. A couple of questions. The one is there an archive law in Sudan? Are government ministries compelled to deposit their papers at the National Archives? And what kind of access is there? What kind of termination date before you can have access to them? For instance, if I'm interested in law cases, et cetera, et cetera. So that's one dealing with government departments. On the other hand, non-governmental fora, say, for instance, the papers of the Sudan Football Association or, other cultural organizations and sporting bodies, et cetera, et cetera. Where are those papers if one wants to do research on them and create knowledge about the whole plethora of things happening in the country or that has happened? Finally, is it very Khartoum-centric, or how does a province like, say, Kordofan feature in this? I mean, do you have similar collection of data for digitization in the provinces? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you, Mr. Shamil, and you are most welcome anytime. We would welcome you, with open arms and hearts in Khartoum. We have not yet initiated any informal exchanges, but I'm very happy to do that in the near future. Yeah, there is a law. There has been a law which has been there for many years, since the inception, actually, of the predecessor, I would say, of the National Archives, and this law has been updated regularly, and there is an obligation on public institutions, ministries, departments, and semi-public institutions such as football associations, singers associations, and other associations, including also some the newspapers, of course, and information outlets and all that. There is an obligation on them to to provide copies of their products and items in the national archives, and that's why I think it's a very rich one. It has millions and millions of items have been they are there. But of course, now the issue is how the issue of storage, the issue of conservation, the issue of restoration, and the issue of digitization, the issue of access, it remains. There is a website that you can access for the National Archive, and I think it's quite clear, you know, to guide you as how to access it. The non-governmental fora, I have answered that. Actually, a few days ago, well, incidentally, someone was asking a question about the Full Board Association and the history of that football association. And the National Archives has been very useful, by the way, because Sudan is the country that hosted the inception of the Africa Football Association, what they call the CAF now. And it, which was initiated in 1957. And in 2007, when at the 50th anniversary, the National Archive was very useful to provide some of the items. Or the archives of the Football Association, which was all African countries joined in that. Cartoon-centric, to a far extent it is, but we have, now we have efforts in order to have branches of the National Library and branches of the National Archives in some of the state capitals. This work has started a few years ago, but I admit that it needs to be further reinforced. We are still lacking in that, I would say, national coverage. But we do have representatives in Al-Lubayyid, for example, or Al-Fashir, or Kassala, or Sudan, etc., who provide us with. And the National Archives is much better structured than the National Library because they are older, they have been there, and they have a law, and that law is very strict, and they are, you know, they have an obligation actually to collect all those items. And they have, I think, I have some of the outlets and some of the branches who are doing that to them, but we need to do more.
Great, thank you very much. Is there any more questions? I think we have one more at the back, and I think then we'll need to move on.
Hello, my name is Gordana Kelava. My question refers to your work in education in emergencies. How do you physically protect the archive of natural disaster, crisis, political uproar?
That's a very good question. That's a very good question. And I regret to say that, and here maybe I'll talk partially on what UNESCO regrets a lot. The damage that conflict and wars are doing to national heritage and archives around the world. You have followed what happened in Timbuktu, you have followed what happened in Mosul, you have followed what happened recently in Syria, UNESCO, UNESCO does not have an army to protect these items. What we do our best to engage with the various parties in a conflict in order to raise their awareness of the importance of preservation of this heritage, which is a heritage, a mankind heritage. Unfortunately, we are not always listened to. So my answer to you, we are doing all we can to preserve these archives, but sometimes, unfortunately, we are confronted with very ugly realities. I'm very happy that finally Timbuktu, the archive center in Timbuktu, which has been built thanks to support our friends from South Africa, I think they are represented here, has been salvaged and finally it's functioning again and has been protected. I hope that we are going to do the same thing for other archives around the world.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sati. Let's thank Dr. Sati, and we're moving on. Thank you.
Yeah. I wish you a good continuation, a successful conference, and I look forward to the opportunity of meeting with you soon, all so that we can continue the good work. Thank you very much, and have a good day.
Thank you. Bye-bye.